Seahawks went to Maui that they were pretty good and we had a lot of fun there, but Coach, I guess nobody ever dreamed it'd be the kind of a season it turned out to be.
Well,
maybe you did.
Well, no, you've heard me say thousands of times, I never go down the schedule and try to determine what our record can be because I want to play each and every game as we come. I don't want to form any opinions and give those to the team, but I thought we were going to be very good, and I knew that the kids worked extremely hard. We had a chance to be one of the best, if not the best team in the country, and one of the teams that would have a chance to win a national championship at the end, and I think they've done that and stepped up to just every challenge, just about every challenge that's been in front of them.
And, of course, all those injuries that befell the team during the course of the year. Let's look back on the 1996-97 season and enjoy it together again.
Long before this phenomenal season ever began, the Jayhawks received some stunning news. A wrist injury would force senior point guard Jock Vaughn to miss the first 10 ball games. Over the course of the season, the Jayhawks would become all too familiar with adversity. It all got underway October 18th at the annual Late Night with Roy Williams. Scott Pollard stole the show with a surprise engagement. The Hawks then jetted out west for a hard-fought season-opening victory against Santa Clara.
And this basketball season is underway. And the tip goes to Pollard and down to Pierce. And he slams it in from the left-hand side for the Jayhawks.
And then it was on to Hawaii for the Maui Classic. After destroying LSU, Kansas faced a fired-up California team in the second round.
Good. Boy, they let him get away with that. He'll score a lot. Slings it over to Jared Haas. Haas goes inside. Reverse layup. Good! He's fouled! The basket counts!
I cannot believe that shot went in.
The Maui Classic Championship game pitted the Jayhawks against the Virginia Cavaliers.
Courtney Alexander in the lane. Alini and block! Taken by Kansas. Rafe LaFrenz.
There's the old rule of verticality. Pollard went straight up.
At the other end, Pollard dunks it. AU's on a run. AU back with it, leading by 13. There's a lob into Rafe, and he stuffed it up over his head.
One. Rafe LaFrenz earned tournament MVP honors. This was the 1,600th win in Kansas basketball history. After a brief stop in Lawrence for a home opening victory over San Diego, it was on to Chicago's United Center for ESPN's Grade 8 event. The college basketball world took note of this one as the nation's new number one team squared off against the fourth-ranked Cincinnati Bearcats. Cincinnati jumped out to a 12-point halftime lead. However, KU's Paul Pierce sparked a furious second-half rally to turn back the Bearcats.
Three-point line and stops it. He turned down an open three and took it to the goal.
From there, it was back out west for a meeting with the UCLA Bruins in historic Pauley Pavilion. Rafe LaFrenz scored a career-high 31 points as KU raced past the Bruins 96-83. After three straight home victories, the night every Kansas fan had been waiting for finally arrived.
Now, here we go. Into the ball game. Jock Vaughn, he'll be waved in, and here he comes. Listen to the crowd! Wow, what a great moment.
Washburn by 25 points. The Hawks season record was now at 11-0. After routing the Brown Bears, the Jayhawks traveled to Manhattan, Kansas. There they faced a fired-up Wildcat club.
Got it.
The Jayhawks fought through a rough shooting night, held on for the three-point victory.
Back up and good!
Kansas then put together successive victories over Texas, Niagara, and Baylor. They returned home January 13th for a conference showdown against the league's second-place team, Iowa State.
Holloway in the corner, out to Willoughby, open for a three. Look out. Got it. Boy, you can see that coming.
After suffering a severe ankle injury just 2 days before, senior Scott Pollard shrugged off the pain, helped lead the Jayhawks to a 13-point victory.
Pollard for an easy one.
Hi, we're the number one ranked Kansas Jayhawks, and we took the day off to scout some of our competition.
Oh, baby!
Yes, it was the number one ranked Kansas Jayhawks that opened the show for ESPN SportsCenter on January 18th.
Our number one priority is watching SportsCenter. Next!
The next day, they had to overcome a 16-point first-half deficit against Connecticut to maintain their perfect record.
It was a three-point shot by Hamilton that would have given them the lead. Instead, at the other end, there's Billy Thomas.
I was waiting for that.
Need a big stop here. There's Thomas again firing. Thomas with two huge threes.
Although he was injured and barely able to play, Jock Vaughn captured the all-time Big 8 assist record at 688. After crushing Texas A&M, the Hawks again received some devastating news. An x-ray of Scott Pollard's left foot showed a stress fracture that would force him to miss the next 8 ball games. Without their senior center, the Hawks headed to Boulder, Colorado for a showdown with the Buffaloes. Victory on this Super Bowl Sunday would give the Buffs a share of the conference lead. 18th-ranked Colorado trailed early, but stormed back to take the lead with just under 9 minutes left in the game.
What a turnaround that was!
But once again, the Jayhawks met the challenge. It was a 10-0 Kansas run that turned back the Buffs 77-68.
He scores!
Boy, he was so determined that time.
Over to Jarrett, double team, the Buffs in a zone, into LaFrenz, inside, he scores! 5:14 to go, Jock into the lane, he drives, he got it! Off the glass! Hawks have it right back, now inside, 2 minutes to go. Paul Pierce plays into B.J. for a jam! An over-the-top pass from Pierce to B.J. for a stop!
Up next, the Red Raiders of Texas Tech, who jumped out to a 16-point lead midway through the first half. However, KU's Ray LaFrenz would not allow the Jayhawks to lose this night. His 21 points faced Kansas in the 86-77 victory. Just 3 days later, the Jayhawks again found themselves in a nail-biter. This time it was against the Nebraska Cornhuskers.
It's good! And a foul! Larry Warren scores, and a foul on Kansas.
While it took a thrilling overtime, the Jayhawks prevailed.
Here's Rafe inside. He got it! He's fouled! The basket counts! What an effort by Rafe LaFrenz!
The 22-0 mark was now the best start by a Kansas team in the school's 99-year history. All good things must come to an end, and it was a painful double overtime loss to the Missouri Tigers in Columbia that brought the Jayhawks' incredible winning streak to a halt.
Dribble penetration. Vaughn had it. Missouri gets it.
Although the Hawks fell short, no one could deny this was one of the truly great games of the college basketball season. From there, the Jayhawks traveled up the road to Ames, Iowa for another difficult challenge. A red-hot Dedrick Willoughby could not overcome a great Kansas team effort. The Jayhawks moved to 23-1 and retained their number one ranking to the next college basketball poll.
Scores! The final, Kansas 69, Iowa State 62, and Roy Williams.
Packed Allen Fieldhouse was a welcome sight to these road-weary Jayhawks. The Big 12 championship hanging in the balance, they put together impressive back-to-back victories over Oklahoma State and Colorado.
Is it in and a steal? They took it away from Phillips. Here comes Robertson to Ray for a stop!
After waiting 13 long days, the Jayhawks finally had their chance of redemption. In front of a Big Monday ESPN audience, Norm Stewart brought his Missouri Tigers to electric Allen Fieldhouse. Round two again was a hard-fought affair.
Three, tie game. You can see that one coming. Jason Sutherland ties the ball game for three. Now, near steal, Jock's got it. And he gives it to Billy. Billy up the court to Rafe. Rafe stuffs it.
Boy, that was lightning quick.
In the end, the Hawks were too much for the Tigers as Kansas atoned for their only regular season loss.
Pierce to Rafe LaFrenz. KU by
a jam-packed Allen Fieldhouse crowd showered the seniors with flowers and heartfelt emotion during this, their final home game. After a sluggish start, Kansas wrote a perfect ending for the seniors. It was a moment no one wanted to end. Later, Kansas was in Norman, Oklahoma, face a hungry Sooner basketball team. Once again, there was a thrilling ending for the Hawks. However, time ran out on the Sooners, and Kansas escapes with a hard-fought two-point victory.
To go. Hatch takes it away. Here comes a good.
Kansas closed out the regular season with a 20-point victory at Nebraska. This past weekend, they made a clean sweep to the inaugural Big 12 tournament title in Kansas City. Now a number one seed in the Southeast Regional, the Jayhawks begin play this Thursday against Jackson State. For the KU Basketball Tournament Special, I'm Mike DeNito.
And Mike did a fantastic job of summing up a great season. Wasn't that good?
That was good. The thing that's better than that, though, is all those memories. They last a little longer than the 10 minutes that it took to summarize them there.
That's
but
right.
A great, great year. And again, hopefully we've got some things left that we'll be able to talk about and feel good about. But I've said this many, many times. No one can say it with the conviction that I do, that I've got the best group of kids in the world.
Well, the chemistry really seems to be there on this year's team,
whatever
that
leadership. It's got great leadership. They care about each other. They enjoy other people's successes, and it's a special group.
All right. Well, there have been some wonderful honors come the way of the Jayhawks, and that's our next feature, which we'll look in on right after we take time out for this. Are a nice part of success, and Kansas has had a lot of them. Coach, the Big 12 Coach of the Year, for the great job he did with all the injuries that befell the team. Rafe, the Player of the Year in the Big 12, and just this week, Rafe named First Team Associated Press All-American, and Jock named Second Team Associated Press All-American. You have to feel awfully proud of that.
Well, we are, and as a matter of fact, Rafe was First Team United States Basketball Writers All-American. Jock was Second Team there. Paul's been honorable mention All-American.
And Scott.
Scott was honorable mention All-American. Paul and I think Jared was third team All-League. Paul was second team along with Jock. So, but I've always said the teams that win, those players get the awards and rewards. And,
yeah.
And I think it's very deserved by our guys. And Rafe has just had a phenomenal year. And when Scott went down, he was the inside scoring threat, BJ's defender and rebounder, and he just sort of raised his level of play even another notch, and it was a heck of a run for him.
As the Big 12 honored Coach and honored Rafe, we had an opportunity to capture those moments, so let's go back and watch them again.
Okay, first of all, I'd like to thank the University Club for selecting me for this award. It's obviously very flattering. I'd like to thank my coaches and teammates. It's been a great year, and we hope to keep the ball rolling throughout March. So thank you very much.
And right now, I'd like to introduce you to the Coach of the Year in the Big 12.
I'll just say that coaches' awards are one of those flattering things, but I'm not being humble, I'm being truthful when I say that this award means something to me, but it should mean more to our players because they're the ones that are responsible for it. When you have Rafe LaFrance and Paul Pierce, Jock Vaughn, Scott Pollard, Jared Haas, BJ, Ryan, Billy, those guys that are able to step up, they have a habit of making me look good, and I hope they keep doing it for a very long time. Thank you.
You know, as you look in on Rafe, he's matured so much, and yet he's still a happy kid with that wonderful smile. I hope he never loses that.
Well, I do too, and I think when I think about this season, and hopefully when I'm thinking about it in the summer, I'll think about the same thing as those smiles of his during the games.
Yeah.
Because I believe that he really has enjoyed this season, enjoyed playing, and when you're around this group of kids, if you don't enjoy yourself, then there's something wrong with you, and I've really enjoyed myself.
And his comments on being named All-American, I think, were very meaningful, and he gave most of the credit to his teammates.
Well, you know, I think the first part of it should go to him because of how the hard work that he's put in his ability, and in this past summer, he did work much harder than he's ever worked, and I think it shows in his play. And at the same time, he did give credit to his teammates because they enable him to do those things that he does extremely well, and that's put the ball in the basket, rebound, and they've known that he was a guy that could do that for them, and they went to him, and he has an ability to score, and everybody wants to shoot, everybody wants to score, but they realize he has that special ability, and his teammates kept going to him.
Coach, obviously, when they pick All-American anymore, they don't pick by position, do they?
No, they don't, and I think that's the best way.
Okay?
I think, yeah, give the five guys who've had the best year. And I think if Jock had not been hurt early in the year, then I think he would have had a great chance to be first-team All-American, too.
Okay, well, we've seen some highlights, but we haven't really zeroed in on spectacular plays of the year. And that's our next feature on our pre-NCAA tournament special, so stay tuned. On a season like this, all of us have certain plays, certain memories that stand out in our minds. What plays do you remember? Any particular ones?
Oh, there's no doubt in my mind. In Maui, Jared Hess turned the basketball over, but before the other team could even gain possession, he dove on that floor as hard as I've ever seen anybody and reclaimed the basketball and got it to our player. And I think Ryan ended up making a basket because of it. But I think that was as good a steal as I've ever seen in my entire life. And the most amazing effort and anticipation I've ever seen. Rafe's big follow dunk against Missouri would definitely qualify, and Paul's drive and on the backdoor pass from Jock in the tournament against Missouri and his dunk. Ryan's 40-footer. I got a lot of them.
Well, let's enjoy some of the great plays of the 1997 season together right here.
Move it. You like to move it.
That's the first deal over to Billy. Billy shoots. Hit it! He got it! A three! Baltimore. Here's a shot from out front off the glass. It's good by Joel Branstrom. Robertson right side to Jared. Jared a guard. Shot up and good! It's good! It's a three-pointer! 7 seconds. Jock out front. A three. Good! A three-pointer by Jock.
Tech lead, McGrath turns, shoots, got it. Steve Reeve with a score.
LaFrance has it, and the game is tied.
Against Sutherland, Robertson up that court, a long jumper.
Good! Oh. He hit it, about a 40-footer. Halftime is here.
the three. He hit it! Scott Pollard! Pierce penetrates the three-point line and stops it. Here's Jock shooting in the lane and missing. Rafe stuffed it in there! Rafe LaFrance with a thunder jam!
Boy, what a follow. Rafe was sky high above the hoop, and he just drove it home. Tremendous play by Rafe.
Jayhawks have a...
Defense, dish... Let's see.
The soaring.
Pressure and jams. That's good feature.
Yeah, and it didn't. My two that stand out most are Rafe's dunk there against Missouri and then Jared Steele against, I think it was against in the California game. I'm not positive. I know it was in Maui right in front of our bench, and it was an unbelievable steal after he had turned it over himself, you know, so maybe had a little more incentive.
Right.
But though that the effort of Jared's is the most important thing, and most people wouldn't even try to do it. Not only did he try to do it, he felt like he could, he had confidence he could, he did it, and then we end up scoring.
We've talked so much about all the other guys who are great, but Jared not getting as many honors postseason as everybody else, but playing with that broken wrist. And
he's been phenomenal for us the entire season, and defensively what he did with help from Jock and Paul and against Dedrick Willoughby in Iowa State game is something I'll never forget.
Right. Well, better get your handkerchief out, because our next feature, we go back and remember the seniors and pay tribute to them once again. So stay tuned, and we'll be right back. Six members. Roy tried to start all six of them on Seniors Day and almost got away with it. But let's look back on these wonderful seniors.
Something in your eyes makes me want to lose myself. Makes me want to lose myself in your arms. There's something in your voice makes my heart beat fast. Hope this feeling lasts the rest of my life. If you so long, if you knew how I wanted someone to come along and change my life the way you've done. Feels like home to me. Feels like and I can almost see through the dark there's a light. If you knew how much this moment means to me and how long I've waited.
To watch that many more times, do you?
I tell you what, Mike DeNito, as we've said before, but we don't give him enough credit on the air, does a fantastic job with those features, and he's got good material to work with there, but I tell you, Michael does a great job, and I'm like you, I can't watch too much of that because they mean so much to me.
You know, Jared said he was born in California, but he said, I'll always have a lot of Kansas blood in my body from here on.
Yeah, you know, it's a kind of group that they're very sensitive, and they care about people, and I think they care about the right things, and I think they love the things that can love them back and not anything else. And it's there's a lot of lucky people in the world, but nobody luckier than Roy Williams.
We'll be back to look ahead to the NCAA tournament. Let's take a break. There.
That's right.
What do you think about the four seeds?
Well, you
were
know,
you surprised at North Carolina?
No, because the 12th straight at the end of the season. I mean, and on the road, in the conference, run it out through the entire conference tournament. I'm so pleased for Coach Smith. He's two victories away from breaking Adolph Rupp's record, one victory away from tying it, two victories away from breaking it. I'd love to be able to get there to see that game myself, but I don't think we can swing that. But
would you mind playing him again?
No, I'd love to, because that'd mean both of us are in the Final Four, and I think it's a fitting tribute for what he's done. I think the best coaching job in the country, and but I'd love to be there playing in Indianapolis, and this group deserves that. This group has worked hard enough to get there, and we got to get lucky. We realize that, but our first focus has got to be Jackson State and going to Memphis, and not just old Roy eating ribs at Rendezvous, but we've got to go there and play well.
And a couple of your guys, Steve Robinson and Kevin Stallings, are in the big dance.
Yeah, you know, Kevin opens up against Iowa State. He and I have already talked a little bit. Steve opens up against Boston University, but I think they'll do very, very well. I'm very proud of them, and they take some of those Kansas basketball things back to their schools and have been successful with it.
Is the West the toughest regional, or do you buy that?
I don't buy that at all, because we've got the number one seed of number one seeds in Kansas. We've got the number two seed of all the two seeds in Duke.
Yeah.
And the people that say the West is the toughest are those people in the West. But I like this morning's paper said the West was the easiest, and I would take that.
Uh-huh. Well, it's going to be a fantastic tournament. As you know, Kansas battling Jackson State on Thursday. It's an 11-25 game. And then the Jayhawks, if they should prevail there, would play the winner of the Purdue-Rhode Island game. You mentioned something about Purdue. What about Rhode Island?
Got a great club, little guard Tyson Wheeler, who's very effective for them. Don't know as much about them because I don't know the coach as well as I do Gene Cady. And so when I watch games, I usually watch games that I have contact with the coaches, because that's a pretty important factor of it for me.
Right. It's been fun to be with you these last 59 and so odd minutes. We hope you've enjoyed our NCAA pre-tournament special. We'll wish the Jayhawks good luck, and who knows, we may be back with you for another telecast if things go well. So thanks for tuning in.